This will employ our understanding of the partial pressure which we have just acquired, this knowledge of partial pressure. So, I will make an alveolus. This is the alveolus. This is the alveolar capillary surrounding it. Okay, this is where the deoxygenated blood comes from. Deoxygenated blood, and this is where the oxygenated blood leaves. Okay, so this is the flow pattern. You understand? Okay, alveolus, capillary surrounding it, blood coming from here, going through and leaving this whole setup. Done? Can you see this at the back? So you get air here. Air is from here. This pressure inside here is denoted by P, small a, capital A. Capital A. And this P is? So you can work out any partial pressure, you just need to put it right here, next to it, in the subscript for any particular gas. For if it's oxygen, you write oxygen here and write down here, okay? Now, let's look at how carbon monoxide behaves in this setup and then compare to it how nitrous oxide, I'll tell you why we are using these gases in this setup. So let's start with carbon monoxide. Let's solve it for carbon monoxide. Let's say that single breath test that I just hinted towards, we have done that. We have inhaled carbon monoxide in a single breath. Carbon monoxide usually in the atmosphere is a very trace gas. So it's hardly, it's 0.00 something concentration. So it's not really injurious normally in the atmospheric breathing. However, let's assume that we actually have inhaled one single breath of concentrated carbon monoxide. So it has given here inside the alveolus, the level of carbon monoxide has gone up, okay, in this particular experiment, right? Now, with carbon monoxide inside, let's start the blood coming in. Deoxygenated blood is now entering into the capillary from here, and it starts to move, coming from here, it starts to move through its route, okay? What will happen? What will happen is that carbon monoxide will start to move inside this blood. Yes? But what will happen is that, like a sponge absorbs water, the hemoglobin will start getting soaked with carbon monoxide. Okay? So there's hardly any partial pressure exerted by carbon monoxide in the blood, because as soon as it gets dissolved, it immediately, such is the high affinity of hemoglobin for carbon monoxide that it cannot literally stay in dissolved form. It just goes inside the RBCs and binds to the hemoglobin. So what would you say? The gradient between alveolus and blood, this is partial pressure, very less partial pressure because of the situation I just described. Would you say that this partial pressure like this, the gradient, will be maintained? In the blood, you can hardly exert any partial pressure because it doesn't stay in dissolved form. It just goes and gets, it's like hemoglobin is the magnet for carbon monoxide. It just attracts it. So let's say 5 molecules transferred from alveolus of carbon monoxide into blood. Yes? They must have entered the plasma. As soon as they arrive in plasma, they're just sucked into the hemoglobin. Yes? So what is left in plasma? Nothing. Plasma is now again available for more carbon dioxide molecules and more and so on and so forth. So would you say that the partial pressure gradient is always there when it comes to this setup. So it doesn't matter, for example, you introduce 5 ml of blood and then you stop blood. It's our experiment, we can do whatever we want. So you have introduced only 5 ml of blood and then stopped blood flow. So that 5 ml of blood is now moving through the through this whole thing, right? As it goes down the route, this whole thing happens. And the availability of carbon monoxide gradient is there because its hemoglobin is just soaking up carbon monoxide, hence the gradient is always there. Okay? This type of behavior is referred to as diffusion-limited gas exchange. The limitation is by diffusion, okay, as opposed to perfusion, which I'll just explain, and then you'll be able to understand. It's a very tricky topic to understand when you have heard it for the first time, okay? But it's a crucial thing as we'll move along. Do you understand how carbon monoxide behaves and why, and what we mean by diffusion limited gas exchange? Are there any questions? All right. Let's now work it for nitrous oxide. What N2O? What is nitrous oxide? Laughing gas. Yeah. So let's inhale some laughing gas. Okay. Why have we taken this particular gas? I'll tell you. But before that, just as a wrap-up of the first concept, the diffusion-limited thing. In both cases, just remember the partial pressure concept and you'll be good. If you forget that the key concept, in any complication, there has to be some key concept which you, if you understand and you keep holding on to, you will never forget the whole thing. Though that key concept here, in this case, is how gases exert partial pressure. Okay? Hold on to that. And if there is a partial pressure being exerted in blood, this will slow down gas transfer. Just in the case with carbon monoxide, it couldn't hold its partial pressure in blood. It kept on slipping to the hemoglobin, hence availability of free space was there always for alveolar carbon monoxide to just fire in more. Just remember this process and you'll be good, okay? Now, if we solve it for nitrous oxide, what's the dip? There's a reason why we are comparing these two gases. Carbon monoxide just can't stay away from hemoglobin, and nitrous oxide does not want anything to do with hemoglobin. When you inhale nitrous oxide, it crosses the respiratory membrane, fine. However, it stays in dissolved form. It does not combine with hemoglobin. It has no receptor to bind. So whatever you inhale and whatever passes through, it just becomes dissolved and sits there. Very important point, it sits there. So when nitrous oxide moves into your freshly arrived 5 ml blood unit, it will immediately transfer into blood, dissolve itself, raising the partial pressure of nitrous oxide at a point where it equilibrates with the alveolus. Obviously, it's not going anywhere, it's just sitting in the plasma. So the rise will very quickly become equal to the alveolar PO2, alveolar partial pressure of nitrous oxide. Are you with me? This is a crucial point. Should I repeat it? No. Kabhi aise nahi hua. Ki maine offer kiya, should I repeat it or answer? No, sir, nahi, nahi. We are good, just go. It's always yes, sir. Okay, once again, with nitrous oxide, you've inhaled nitrous oxide. It's sitting in the alveolus, whatever its partial pressure is, right? Now you start your experiment. You bring in that same, not the same, a new 5 ml blood. You throw it in from here, from the inlet, and let's see what happens. Well, what happens is that as soon as it comes here, nitrous oxide crosses the brain, the respiratory barrier, okay? At the start of the experiment, it has high concentration here, zero concentration in the blood. Obviously, unless you are a habitual inhaler of nitrous oxide, its partial pressure would be zero in blood, right? It's normal blood that you take. So as soon as new blood comes in, it rushes to it, because there's a gradient. Things always go down the gradient, remember?
Yes.
Right. So it hops in to the blood and it can't find anything to bind to. It just gets dissolved in the plasma and partial pressure starts going up, because we know that partial pressure is only exerted by the dissolved gases in the liquid. So this rise is very spectacular, very quick. And by the time it hits like this bit here, so the initial one-third or even lesser than one-third of the entire length of the capillary, the partial pressure has been equilibrated with the alveolar partial pressure of nitrous oxide. Is this okay?
Yes.
Then the question that must be burning inside your brain is, what happens to this 5 ml blood, which has now equilibrated with the alveolar air, with the rest of the journey? What happens to it? The answer is simple. Nothing. Nothing happens. Nothing can happen. When I say nothing can happen, if you are with me. Why? Because there is no gradient. Because the partial pressure of both chambers is the same. Because this gas does not have anywhere else to go. That's it. This is the law of physics. When it equilibrates, the 5 ml will just lounge around and just do nothing and just travel lonely without any activity, bored throughout this length of the capillary, and out it goes. This setup is referred to as perfusion limited gas exchange. Why? Because if you have to increase the gas content, you need to get yourself new blood. This 5 ml is done. It's engaged, married off, gone. If you want to now transport more nitrous oxide, you get another 5 ml, and so on and so forth. That too will immediately, in the first one-third-ish length of the capillary, get equilibrated, and then veliyan khayega with the rest of the length of the capillary. Nothing to do because it has equilibrated. You get this? Any questions?
Yes. Sir, how do we excrete
nitrous oxide out? Well, you inhale it out. You exhale it out. Metabolism of nitrous oxide is not the part of this presentation. The thing is, these two experiments we did because oxygen follows and carbon dioxide follows some of these patterns. In fact, oxygen follows both patterns. So In diffusion limited exchange, the entire length of the capillary is operative. So you can have a situation where diffusion goes on through the entire level, the entire areas of the capillary. This is something, when I will explain oxygen, you will understand. Now, here is what you need to remember. These are the gases which follow diffusion limitation. So, carbon monoxide, oxygen in strenuous exercise, and oxygen in certain diseases, okay? Carbon monoxide we've just done, okay? Let's see how oxygen behaves in strenuous exercise, okay? And then compare it with oxygen under normal situation and carbon dioxide and nitrous oxide. Nitrous oxide we've already done. Let's first, before we do that, let's start with oxygen under normal concentration or under normal conditions. Why do we say that under normal conditions, oxygen is diffusion limited? Well, this is where the, please remind me to mention transit time later on, transit time. Remember the capillary that I made over there? Just remember that setup. As soon as deoxygenated blood enters into your alveolar capillary, under influence of the high oxygen that you have created inside the alveolus, it starts to get oxygenated. Okay. Now, if you divide the length of the capillary into three parts, first 1/3, 2/3, and 3/3, the efficiency of this whole system is so beautiful that it reaches full oxygenation in the first 1/3, and that's that. So it's typical perfusion limited profile at rest for oxygen. Oxygen is adjusted in a way, everything. So its movement across the membrane, it's arriving in the plasma, the raising of the partial pressure and the binding of the hemoglobin, all are synced in such a way that you don't need a lot of time, transit time. Transit time is the total amount of time the blood is takes in encircling this whole alveolar setup. So at the point of entry to the point of exit, the whole thing is called, the time taken is transit time. So only a fraction of the transit time, oxygen is picked up by the blood, and that's that. The rest of the 2/3 of the travel is I won't say pointless, but it doesn't pick anything. What it came to pick, it already picked during the first 1/3 of the length of the capillary, those initial moments of the transit time. Are you clear?
Yes.
Now we are explaining oxygen. Okay. So, why have such a long capillary then? Why not have a shorter capillary? There's no point in having a long capillary. Well, no, there is a point, a big point. Because you won't be at rest all the time, would you?
Yes.
You would go into exercise. You might, Allah forbid, contract a disease which affects gas transfer. In those situations, oxygen transfer becomes all along the capillary. It becomes diffusion limited. At rest, it is perfusion limited. I will give you MCQs. I don't care if it's not in guidance. I taught you this. Okay? And this comes as part of a standard respiratory course, respiration course in the world. He must have mentioned it somewhere in a small paragraph. It's impossible that he hasn't mentioned. But he doesn't explain it. So, oxygen at rest is perfusion limited. In strenuous exercise, it's diffusion limited. Let's quickly solve that situation. So in exercise, what's going on? In exercise, you have everything fast. So the blood coming in is faster than at rest. At rest, when it comes, during the initial 1/3, it gets oxygenated. But now, just repeat that sequence like this. Make it quicker. Why quicker? You're exercising. You need more blood oxygenated at a very rapid rate. So the flow of blood through the capillary becomes very, very fast. But we've got it covered. How? Because we switch the mode into diffusion limit. So yes, when it comes quickly, in the first 1/3, listen to this very carefully. In exercise scenario, as soon as the blood at fast speed enters the first 1/3 of the capillary, it doesn't have the time for equilibration because it's fast. So it quickly moves on. But the length of the capillary is optimized that even if you have fast flow, by the end of the capillary, you still will have your bucket full of oxygen. Please tell me you got it.
Yes.
Okay. This explains again oxygen transfer at high altitude. What he has done is he has shown you the same graph, this graph, but this time it's for oxygen. Okay. So look at this graph. At sea level is here, Lahore. All the cities, not all the cities, but sea level means not at high altitude, not inside the sea, at sea level, on the floor of the earth. Okay, that's sea level. At sea level, you have a normal curve for oxygen. Okay, this is the normal curve because it is what limited? Just looking at the curve should tell you that it is perfusion limited. This is the curve of a perfect perfusion limited gas, nitrous oxide. Just by the shape of the graph, you can tell which one is it. If it really goes up like this, that means it's not binding with anything else, but it's only getting dissolved and hence raising its partial pressure. Nitrous oxide, the ideal one, okay? So if this is the graph for oxygen, anything similar, you know what is being talked about. Okay? Oxygen is at rest, at sea level. This is the kind of graph that oxygen will make, okay? This is that graph. It's very close to what you just saw, okay? This blue line here. But if the guy has fibrosis, this graph shifts downwards and flattens out. And you can see what happens because you have impaired the diffusion. Fibrosis impairs diffusion of oxygen or any other gas across the respiratory membrane. Hence, this graph becomes this graph. Okay? This is done. Actually, we will be able to do it anyway. Now compare it to high altitude. The only difference, what you need to do is take this graph, take it like this, and compress it downwards. This, you will appear with this. Why? Because at high altitude, the atmospheric oxygen, let's say, is at half. So at sea level, it's 100. You get 100 PO2 in alveoli. But when you go to a high altitude, you only get 50. This is the alveolar air, this green dotted line. This needs to be now dropped down to this. So this is now the upper limit of this diagram. The whole thing now needs to be compressed. So the maximum oxygen in blood, the maximum that can go up is up till 50%. The graph skews and becomes this curve. So at high altitude, even if you're a normal human being, you have no diseases whatsoever, this will become the graph. This is more diffusion limit. It's flattening out. Remember, if it goes up like a rocket or anything on this line, it is a perfusion limited gas. If it flattens, goes horizontal, it is a more diffusion limited gas. So look at this. This is more diffusion limited. And if the poor guy has fibrosis and he wants to go to Skardu, then he's in big trouble because his graph will even more flatten out than the normal human being. Okay, you've done this.